And I want you to watch me take action. I'm going to put up a phone number, and it'll be the phone number for the legislative message line. There is a room in the Capitol, just down the street, that has a big room full of people who take messages for the legislators. And we're going to say, this is the issue, and then I want you to call right now. And there's like 25 or 50 operators, so if you can't get through, then try again. Remember to be brief, to say who you are, and you should, don't leave a message for everybody. Leave a message for your legislator, because that's who you can affect. So legislators are not going to affect. If you do not know who your legislator is, then you can either ask the operator and say, I live in this county, in this town, and they can look it up for you. If you want to look it up, on the front desk of the foyer, there are multiple papers and books that list all the legislators and all of their counties. So after I give you a briefing about a bill, there will be a 2-minute countdown where you can call, leave a message, be polite, say I'd like to be for it or against it, and then there's something important that you can ask, and add in, contact me back with what you will be doing. Otherwise, you let them off the hook, and they get a message, they don't have to do anything. Say, this is who I am, I'm your voter, this is what I'd like to do, what will you be doing? Now, with that being said, let's talk about the first bill. Okay, first bill we're going to talk about, our House bill. And now, if you have the program, on the back of the program, there's a place for notes. I hope you'll be taking notes. Because not only can you call today, there's also the address on the back of the program where you can write letters for these issues. Go back to your church, have a fellowship. Call it a Patriot Night or something. Invite some people, have a barbecue or something, and talk about the issues you learned here. Have the church write a bunch of letters, and there's the address you can mail it in. Here's the first issue we're going to talk about, marijuana. House Bill number 57 would make medical use of marijuana legal in Kentucky, which is always just to push the door to make it legal just as long as you want. In fact, that bill is House Bill 76, would make marijuana use legal to use in Kentucky. I can stand on the street corner and smoke it in front of the cop. Now, people who are pushing this have been to the Capitol. They have met with these people. I see them all in different valleys pushing this. This has been passed in multiple other states. And it's caused a lot of regulatory confusion because people don't know how to do it, how to regulate it. It has caused an increase in drug-related school expulsions. There has been a spike in edible marijuana products relating to more emergency room visits and deaths, specifically more deaths by children and pets who are eating the edible products. Now, supporters of this say, well, marijuana never hurt anybody, alcohol's bad, and it hurts tons of people, but nobody ever died from marijuana. I would like to know what organization keeps track of something that never happened. They say that it never happened. Well, I'll tell you it did happen. Here's some facts. According to the 2012 National Survey on Drug Use, there are 2.7 million people who are now addicted to marijuana. So yes, it is addictive. The National Institute on Drug Abuse in 2016 said this, quote, outside of alcohol, marijuana is the most common drug found in all fatal car crashes in the United States, end quote. So yes, it is responsible for tens of thousands of deaths per year. The report goes on to say the reason for the deaths on the highway is marijuana makes you lose the ability to track items in motion. You ever see those druggies and they just move their hand in front of their face? Because they can't track items in motion as well. And when you're driving, the landscape is in motion and other cars, and that's why, except alcohol, it's the most common drug in all fatal car crashes. So this would be horrible for our state, and some people, the supporters, say it cures depression. That is fake news. Long-term use of marijuana causes depression. I'm depressed right now because they say it's less harmful than cigarettes. That is fake news. Marijuana smoke contains 2 times as much tar as cigarette smoke. And the reports go on and on. It increases binge drinking by an average of 15 to 22% in states where where it has to be legalized. And the last thing I'm going to say about it, there's tons more, is when you get people on marijuana, you know what they want to do?
Nothing.
They just want to sit around and not work and just eat. Is that really what our country is? We need to go to work. So, we're now going to take time to take action on this. If you do not, this can get passed into law in about 2 weeks. So, we're going to take 2 minutes. The phone number will be up there. Call. Let your voice be known. The House bill numbers will be there. Be brief.
Yes, we're going to the stage. A gentleman is going to give you a little history lesson. And I'm sure it will be a blessing talking about America's Christian heritage. Please help me welcome American Christians of Kentucky, Brother Don Pinson.
Thank you.
church of the Lord Jesus in order to go fight wars. He said, you've done the wrong thing. A number of months later, as Frederick Muhlenberg stood outside his church in New York and watched the British soldiers set fire to it, he had changed his heart. And he joined Washington's army and served with distinction through the Revolutionary War. Indeed, he got so involved in the creation of this new government that it would be Frederick Muhlenberg who was chosen to be the first speaker of the new House of Representatives of the United States under the new Constitution. Pastors got involved in government to make sure that it operated within the boundaries of the Word of God. Brothers and sisters, today, in this issue of should Christians be involved in government, there's really only one question to be answered. That is, who created civil government? Did God create civil government? Because if he did, surely he would want us as his people to steward it instead of the people of the world. I mean, is that not logical?
Yes, yes, yes.
Consider it. From the Garden of Eden to Noah, God himself administered civil government or administered government to men. It was God who placed angels around the tree of life to keep mankind from getting to that tree. He was controlling, which is what the word government means, to control. He was controlling access to the tree of life. God was operating government. When Cain sinned against Abel and killed his brother, it was God who pronounced judgment on Cain. When the people of Noah's day became so immoral and so violent, God administered judgment. God was operating government in the earth. However, with Noah, there came a change. After the flood, as Noah is offering up to God thanksgiving that he and his family have been preserved, God speaks to Noah and he says these words in Genesis 9 and verse 6. Whosoever sheds man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. For in the image of God, he made he man. You see, now God transfers the administration of government to mankind. That's why it's called civil government. The word civil, according to Merriam Webster's original dictionary, the word civil means relating to the community. And so God is now transferring to the community the choice of their rulers who will then administer civil government. And the murderer, of course, was to have his own life taken in payment for the life that he took. And so God starts civil government after the flood, and now government is of the people, by the people, and for the people, as John Wycliffe would write in the introduction to his Bible that he translated in 1382. And so, since God created civil government, it must be the church that teaches civil government. It must be the church that expounds from the scripture what government is to be, what civil government is to be. Indeed, it's what Jesus commissioned us as his followers to do. In Matthew 28, long ago, up here a few minutes ago, Jesus said, go ye therefore and teach all nations. That word nations in the Greek, and I don't pretend to be a Greek scholar, but I do have strong supports. Mr. Strong in his concordance says that in the Greek language, that's the word ethnos, and it means a tribal group. In other words, a group of people that can be defined by a boundary, philosophically or physically. Most of the time it was physical. Jesus is literally telling us to disciple the nations as well as the individuals in the nations. We're discipling national structures. In other words, the institutions that make up a nation, the home, the church, civil government, the business community, and education, we're to disciple the institutions just like we're to disciple individuals. Jesus said to do it. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, he said. The pilgrims did this. Indeed, they discipled individuals, homes, their church, the local community, and the education system, the economic system, and the civil government. The pilgrims did that. And they created a community that modeled to the world what a community was like when not only individuals got discipled, but the institutions of the culture got discipled. And so, William Bradford, their governor for Northern history 25 years after they came, who was their governor for 35 years, he knew them inside and out, he'd been with the movement since he was in his early teenage years. William Bradford writes these words. Last and not, William Bradford would write these words. He said, last and not least. Last and not least, they cherished, talking about why the pilgrims came, they cherished a great hope and inward zeal of the propagating of the gospel of Christ in those remote parts of the world, even though they should be but stepping stones unto others in the performance of so great a work. You see, their aim was to spread the gospel of the kingdom, the dominion of the king, into not only individual families, not only through their own individual church, but they were to spread the gospel of the kingdom of Christ into the institutions of the church. When I learned that truth, it was life-changing for me. The church disciples individuals by teaching new believers how to walk, first of all, in the first four of the Ten Commandments. Because those are the commands that relate to God. And we're not talking about setting up the Ten Commandments and gritting our teeth and saying, okay, I'm going to love God more than anything else, no matter what. Well, that puts in the flesh, and it can't be done that. But we're talking about meeting with God daily in the Scripture, meeting with God daily in His Word. As we read through the Scripture, asking the Holy Spirit to work that love of God toward God in us, so that the Spirit lives the life of God through us. Now, in a sense, as Paul would say in Colossians 1:27, Christ in you, the hope of glory. You see, Paul told us in Corinthians, if any of you are familiar with this verse, he said, but we all, with open face, beholding in a glass, a mirror, in other words, the glory of the Lord, are changed from the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. When we look into this book and we see the image of Jesus, as we're reading it, we ask the Holy Spirit, work His image in me. Flow through me. Express your life through me. When we do that, a miracle occurs, folks, in many of you experience. The Holy Spirit works in us what we cannot work on our own. And He begins to produce the life of Christ through us in this world. And so we begin to get discipled and we're changed into the image of Christ as He teaches us to let Him through us obey those first four commandments. We don't just stop. We then, in the church, disciple new believers in the last six commandments. You notice the first four commandments relate us to God. The last six commandments relate us to our fellow man. What's happening here? We are related to God. We're related to our fellow man. The cross is imprinted on us. God's word, His commandments in and through His people in this process. As we do that, we get discipled as new believers. Then the church goes on, according to what Jesus said, and begins to disciple civil government. Because you see, it's these last six commands that are both the reason for and the framework of civil government. Now, why is that true? Because the commandments of God reveal to us that we're sinners. The law is our brings to Christ. We don't come to Christ without being convicted by the Holy Spirit, by the law of God. It's how He brings us to Christ. Why it's so important to teach the Ten Commandments to our children. As Andrew will say, that he said his first memory of his angel mother, as he called her, was of her teaching him to memorize at her feet the Ten Commandments of God. I would have been our children's testimony. And so, it shows us that we're sinners, and that's the reason for civil government. We'll look at it more just a moment. But it's also a framework of civil government. The laws that make up civil government must be based on the moral law expressed in those last six commandments. In other words, civil government is to keep us from wronging our neighbor. And so, in principle, the laws that are passed must agree with the moral law of God, as Judge Warren Moore has said over and over and over and over again, that wouldn't he be a good nominee for the U.S. Supreme Court? However, our law must be based on the Word of God. As William Blackstone, that jurist that our founders quoted as much as any other man they ever quoted, William Blackstone was saying this way. He said, this we call the revealed law. It is to be found written only in the Holy Scriptures. No human law should be allowed to contradict this.
Amen.
That's right. Amen. The chief men who taught. And so that's what they based their constitutions on, the state, the national, and therefore the commandments are the framework for civil government. So, the civil government wants me to teach the people in the church, those of us that are teachers, pastors, teachers, others in the church, wants me to teach the people of God how to do civil government. By the way, the Pilgrims did civil government, wrote treaties with the Indians, created the Mayflower Compact, the first constitution in America. They did that. It wasn't a lawyer alone. How did they do that? Their pastor, John Robinson, taught the civil law from the Bible.
And therefore they can do that. This is what we've got to do again as pastors and church leaders, teachers. We've got to return to teaching civil government, just like we teach people how to be born again, how to read their Bible, how to relate to their husband, their wife, all the other things that we teach them to disciple them. We've got to teach them a concern civil government.
Once we do that, and they start entering into civil government, like we've seen a number, thank God, that some of them are here now, that are Christians in our civil government, in the state, and in our local governments. Once we do that, civil government begins to disciple the people outside the church. I'm sorry to say, sometimes it has to disciple us inside the church.
Yeah, that's right. That's
ouch.
Right.
However, it's designed, the purpose of civil government, let's just read this so you can see it. By the threat of punishment, rebels against Christ, those who don't have internal self-government and would harm their neighbor, can be made to not wrong their neighbor enough of the time to maintain sufficient order for the institution to function without a lot of interruption. In other words, it's civil government's responsibility to keep people in control who don't keep themselves in control. And therefore, to create order in society. As Noah Webster, the man who wrote the first dictionary of liberty, educated America in the 1800s, Noah Webster would say it this way. He said, good order is the foundation of all good things. We have to have order in society. That's the government's responsibility, is to teach those who haven't learned in their homes, as they should, civil government. Now, Romans 13 and verse 1, you find this passage that many of you are very familiar with. And here's what it says. Let every soul be subject to the higher powers. He says, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. For there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. He starts civil government. Then he says this, whosoever therefore resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation or condemnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. Then he says, for he is the minister of God, talking about civil government servants. He is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he bears not the sword in vain. For he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath on him that doeth evil. That's the purpose of civil government. A number of years ago, we had our present governor, Matt Bevin, was running for U.S. Senate. I wanted to be able to support him, but I didn't know him. Friend of mine introduced me to him over here in the cafeteria at the office building. We sat down and had a great conversation, just over 8 minutes. So I said to him, Mr. Bevin, since we only have a few moments here, I said, let me cut to the chase and just ask you a question that I ask every political candidate that wants my vote. That's this. What is the purpose of civil government? Want to be a civil government servant? What's the purpose of civil government? Let me tell you. Every candidate for national office I ever asked that question to did not know the answer. But our present governor looked at me without a moment's hesitation and said, well, it's to protect God-given rights. And I smiled and said, you are exactly right, sir. You have my support. Civil government is what the purpose of protecting God-given rights. Our founders in America understood both the structure of civil government, the purpose of it, and the spirit in which it should operate. In fact, our founding fathers, when they wrote the Declaration of Independence, identified the purpose of civil government. And you'll remember these words. After Thomas Jefferson says, all men are created equal and are endowed by the Creator with certain unalienable rights. That among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. His very next statement is this. He says that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men. That is the purpose of civil government. It's not to provide anything. It is to protect.